What impact has
luck and personal skills have on your career? And do you think that your case was exceptional in regard to the balance between the two?
You know, I can't imagine a career where luck and personal abilities didn't both work, because let's take the following. In 1956, I received an invitation to go to Harvard for some postdoctoral work in mathematics. It was a program that chose very carefully only 50 people teaching economics and business to train them to even a higher level of math. And if that didn't happen, I wouldn't have met Donald Jacobs, who was the dean, was going to eventually be the dean of Northwestern University's business school, and I wouldn't have gotten probably into marketing. I would have stayed in economics, and so on. So luck and coincidences play a lot, because that wasn't planned by me. It just happened. Personal abilities, I've been always a left-brain person. By that, I mean a very analytical, studious, in a sense, but engaged in the world, seeing what's going on. And then I developed my right brain side, which is called the creative side, and one that synthesizes a lot of things, puts them together, builds new frameworks. So it's a combination of luck and personal abilities.
You've received many awards and Financial Times, I think it was, has announced that you were one of the most important marketing people in the world.
I was very pleased and surprised to be rated as number four in the Financial Times poll, which was conducted with some thousand executives about who they consider as having an impact on their thinking. I was the only marketer in the list of 30 or so. And number four, which means that Peter Drucker, the great and late Peter Drucker, was number one, to no one's surprise. And then there was Bill Gates and Jack Welch, possibly, I can't remember, and then I was number four. I think the rankings change over time, but it meant that I've educated some millions of executives about marketing, because when I started my marketing writing, I noticed that what had been said about marketing was pretty descriptive. What does a salesman do? How do you run a retail store? You know, the 5 points of this and that. There was no analysis. It didn't help you make decisions. It didn't say, how many salesmen should I hire? That's a question. How much should I spend on advertising? That's a question. How should I set the price? That's a question. So what I gave to marketing was a disciplined approach to very difficult questions, but the steps that would give you the data so that your decisions are data-based when you make them. And that took off in my 1967 book, Marketing Management, Analysis, Planning, and Control. So from then on, every few years I've added some new things going on, because marketing is fluid. It's not geometry. It's not even accounting. I mean, it's very fluid. Everyone knows that there are new terms coming in, customization, blogs, podcasts. So I keep up to date with that. In fact, try to be a little ahead and anticipate what's happening. And I'm very pleased that when we talk about leadership, that more company leaders are aware of the importance of the customer, because I've always stressed that your thinking and planning should be from the customer back to the company, not from the company back to the customer. So we are not there to sell our product. We are there to meet needs of people that are not well met or even met at all today. And that kind of customer philosophy was part of the thrust I did. And then I wrote several other books on various subjects.